In this assignment, we're going to make a script to manage the enemy's player detection. Select the robot guard in the hierarchy and click Add Component. Choose New Script and name the script Enemy Sight. Double-click the icon to launch it for editing and prepare the script as usual. We will need three public variables. The first is a float we will call Field of View Angle. This is the number of degrees centered on the forward direction that the enemy can see through. If the player is outside of this field of view, the enemy will not react. We want this to be public so we can tweak it in the inspector, but we'll give it a default of 110 degrees. The next is a Boolean we will call player in sight. This will be true when the enemy can see the player and false otherwise. We need this to be public so that it can be accessed by the decision-making script enemy AI. The last public variable we will need is a vector3 that we will call personal last sighting. This is the last sighting of the player unique to an individual enemy. When the player is spotted by an alarm system or another enemy, this variable will be set to the global sighting position that all the enemies converge upon. However, when the enemy hears the player without seeing him, this will store the player's location without setting the global value to alert the other enemies. Next, we need to set up a series of private references to other components. The first one we will need is a reference to the navmesh agent. This is because we're going to use the length of the path to the player as a measure of how far away the enemy can hear. We will be comparing it to the radius of the sphere collider, so we will need a reference to that too. The animator controller has a player in sight Boolean parameter, which we will need in order to set this script's player in sight Boolean. Therefore, we will need a reference to the animator. The global last known location of the player is in our last player sighting script. As such, we will need a reference to that. We will be using some of the onTriggerEnter functions in this script to detect the player entering the sphere collider, and as such, we will need a reference to the player. Since the enemy can hear the player when he's running or shouting, we will need a reference to the player's animator in order to tell which state he's currently in. When the player is dead, we want our enemy to ignore him, so we will need a reference to the player health script. Since we will be comparing animator controller states in this script, we will need a reference to the hash ID script we wrote earlier that stores them. The last private variable we will need is not a reference, but a variable for storing the personal last sighting from the previous frame. This way we can know if the position of the player has changed. Now that we have all of the variables ready to store our references, we need to actually assign them. We will do this inside the awake function. Also in the awake function, we need to make sure that the personal last sighting and the previous sighting both have the default reset value from last player sighting so that when the game begins, the enemies are not chasing the player. There are a couple of things that we need to do in the update function. Firstly, we need to check if the global sighting of the player has changed, and if it has, update the personal sighting of the player. After this check, we need to change the previous position to be this frame's position. The other thing that we need to do in the update function is to set the player in sight animator parameter. However, we only want to update this whilst the player is alive. If the player is not alive, we want the player in sight parameter to be false. The majority of the code for this script is going to be in an onTriggerStay function. For player in sight to be true, the player being in view must satisfy three conditions. 1. That he is within the trigger zone. 2. That he is in front of the enemy to the extent of the enemy's field of view. And 3. That nothing is blocking the enemy's view of the player. The first condition is satisfied if the colliding game object is the player. At this point, we also need to set the player in sight variable to be false. That way, if the player is in the trigger zone, but the other conditions are not satisfied, then player in sight will default to false. To determine whether the player is within the field of view, we are going to use a function of the Vector3 class called angle. This takes in two Vector3s and returns the angle between them. We will pass in a vector from the enemy to the player, and the enemy's forward vector. If this angle is less than half the field of view angle, then the player is within the field of view. Now we can have the condition to check whether our angle is less than half of the field of view angle variable. Given that the player is within the field of view, we now need to know that there is no obstruction between the enemy and the player. To find this out, we will use a raycast from the enemy to the player. And if something is hit, we will determine whether it is the player or not. For this, we will need to create a raycast hit variable, which we will call hit. Now remember that the root of the enemy FBX is at its feet. This means that if we raycast from its position, its feet, we might hit the floor. Instead, we can use transform.position plus transform.up as our starting position for the raycast. As the model is approximately 2 units tall, and transform.up is 1 up in the y-axis, this is around the center of the model. The direction of the raycast is the direction vector we created earlier for measuring the angle. The direction vector of a raycast is always normalized, so we'll always have a magnitude of 1. The next parameter is the raycast hit variable we have created. And finally, the distance. For this, there is no point in the raycast being any longer than the radius of the collider, for that is where we want to check for the player. Next, we need to check that if we hit something, it is the player. At this point, we know that the player is in sight, so we can set the player in sight variable to true and update the global sighting of the player to alert the other enemies. At this point, we need to deal with the player being heard rather than seen. The conditions for this are that the player is running or shouting. Both of these are animator states that the player could be in, so we need to check for them. We will start by storing the name hash of the player's states on both layers. Now we can compare these variables to the hash IDs. When the enemy hears the player, it may not be a straight line to the target. If the player was just around the corner, then the enemy should be able to hear him. But if they are in a completely different room, then the enemy shouldn't be able to hear through the walls. What we need is a way of telling how far the sound would have to travel, and we can do this by calculating routes using the navmesh. We will keep these calculations in a separate function. We will make the function return the length of the path we're calculating, and it will need to take in a Vector3 as the target position. The first step in this function is to create a new empty navmesh path. Now we are going to use a function of the navmesh agent called calculatePath. This takes in a target destination and the path variable that we've just created. The navmesh path type is a class, which means it's a reference type, one that can be assigned to within a function. This means that our path variable will be affected by the calculatePath function, since we are passing in a reference to the variable. We'll first ensure that the navmesh agent is enabled, and then calculate the path. Part of the navmeshPath class is an array of Vector3s called corners. These are all of the corners on the root of the path. If we added the position of the enemy and the player to this array, then we will have an array of all of the waypoints on the path. We can then add together all of the distances between the waypoints to get the full path length, and therefore the distance that the sound would have to travel to be heard by the enemy. Let's call our array all waypoints and declare its length as the length of the corners array plus 2 more to allow for the enemy and player positions. Now the first point of this array should be the enemy's position. And the last point of the array is the target position, that of the player. All the points in between will be those from the corners array. We can assign these using a for loop, which performs an assignment for each of the corners. Since we don't want to assign the first item in the all waypoints array, the index that we will assign to will be i plus 1. Now we need to create a float to store our path length. We need to initialize it to be 0, since it won't be able to increment if it has not been initialized. We will need another loop. This will iterate over each of the lengths between the waypoints. Therefore, it will need to loop the number of times that is 1 less than the number of waypoints in the array. An array of 3 waypoints will have 2 lengths that join them. An array of 4 waypoints will have 3 lengths, and so on. Then, in each loop, we need to add the distance between one waypoint and the next to the path length variable. Finally, we just need to return the path length. With the function finished, we can put a call to it in our onTriggerEnter function. Since the furthest distance the enemies can hear is the sphere collider's radius, we need to make sure that the length of the path returned from our function is less than or equal to this radius. And if this is the case, we set the personal last sighting to the player's position. The final part of this script is to make sure that player in sight is set to false when the player leaves the trigger zone. This is done very simply with an onTriggerExit function. Now we can save our script and return to the editor. We need to create a new subfolder in our scripts folder to hold this script and others for the enemy. Select the scripts folder and go to Create, Folder, and call this folder Enemy. Then reselect Assets, and expand Scripts, and drag and drop Enemy Sight into the Enemy folder. Now we can save our scene and project, and in the next assignment, we will be making a script to handle passing the parameters for the movement from the NavMesh system to the animator controller.